and above all, my dear group. I take this opportunity to first to thank you for accepting our humble invitation. And it is quite important for us that you are here with us this evening. When I say this, I'm reminded of the significance and importance of this assemblage here by the fact that, as they say in Arabic, that things are known by their opposites. Our neighbor country, India, has been very much interested, and it has been exerting all possible pressure that Azad Kashmir in general and Azad Kashmir particularly should be kept out of all this. And that is why we, because of some limitations, of our own limitations, internal and external, we have not had the privilege of inviting you very often. I think this is perhaps in many years the second gathering that we have had of our ambassadors, the dear ambassadors posted to Pakistan. Again, it became important. Very recently I had the opportunity to address the South Asian Committee of the European Parliament, and the Indian ambassador made very desperate efforts in protesting against my presence there in Strasbourg. But as you know, the European community, I think they felt it, and they to retain or maintain their independence, sovereignty and individuality, they outright rejected the protest of the Indian ambassador, and rather took more interest in my presence than they would have done otherwise. This I am telling you, Excellencies, because of my very long experience. Even the UNDP, of which many of you would be members, was objected to by the Indian government for giving any assistance to Azad Kashmir on the plea that Azad Kashmir is not a recognized government, and therefore they should not get any assistance from the UNDP. I had long deliberations with them, and then I explained to them ultimately that although Azad Kashmir government was not recognized, nor we intend seeking any recognition of this government, but the people of Azad Kashmir and the territory is a part of the globe, and they are recognized by the United Nations. So that way we met their argument, and the UNDP was at ease in dealing with us for the financial assistance. And I know for sure that my movement in outside Pakistan, wherever I went, to brother countries or to the European countries or elsewhere, it was very meticulously followed and objected to, resented and protested against by the Indian side. And in some cases we sometimes doubt that, of course I know for sure that it is not with every country and with every ambassador and with every representative that they contacting, but there are many people who perhaps accept that idea of a recognized or an unrecognized government. But I am grateful to the ambassadors, particularly of the OIC and OIC countries, and even others, many others, you see, who have never bothered about what the Indian government protests against and raises objections to. So that way it makes it quite important from my point of view that Excellencies, you are here today. It would have been my great pleasure and profound desire that you were there in Muzaffarabad with us, but the time constraint and the climate and your own commitments and all that, we studied that very much in detail and then came to the conclusion that we request you here in Islamabad. And there is so much to talk to you, but I will not take much of the time. I'll try to be as brief as possible. As far as I remember, I think this is the second meeting of the Muslim ambassadors that I have had the opportunity to invite. The first one also was called for on account of a very grave situation which was brewing up in Kashmir. And here again today, when we meet, the situation in Kashmir is getting worse every day. And it is my bounden duty, as a matter of fact, both as a Prime Minister and as an individual in politics, that I apprise my brothers of what is happening. You certainly you are quite aware of what is happening, but from our point of view, because I'm quite conscious of, also conscious of the fact that the Indian government has very skillfully drawn a smoke screen over the Kashmir issue, and from various angles they've been tackling. They are friends of Israel, very dear and deep friends. They had a deep friendship with them. At the same time, they enjoy friendship with many of the Muslim countries at the same time. It's a very contradictory phenomena. That is why many things need to be explained, how it comes about. With the breakup of Russia, the conflicts which before the breakup were very important and very serious and demanded immediate action, those conflicts had at that time, before the breakup, they perhaps did not surface very sharply outside. But now after the breakup, they are tending to pose a lot of threat to the situations wherever they occur, and therefore they need to be attended to. Of those areas of conflict which are emerging and which are becoming very powerful, Palestine and Bosnia and Kashmir here next door, you see, is perhaps by far very, very serious. Now, with regard to Kashmir, the political efforts have, in the past, the last few years, they did not yield any result, and it was taken for granted that Kashmir, as claimed by India, is an integral part, and therefore let us forget about it. And, they also managed very skillfully to depict Kashmir as a sort of territorial dispute between the two countries, Pakistan and India, and therefore the other countries should not be very much interested in it. But as the time goes on, and particularly in the last two and a half years, the Kashmiris themselves they laid down their lives and offered sacrifices of unprecedented nature, and they have brought the issue back to life. And today it has attained that importance and significance which it deserved. Therefore, and we know for sure that also that the enemy, the opposing forces are equally strong. They are stronger, far stronger than ourselves. Therefore, I have been saying that maybe the movement in Kashmir succeeds, but we fail. We have seen in the recent past and the previous past things happening like that. And therefore, it becomes a matter of very serious concern for us to take into account all those facts and things to see that the movement also succeeds and we do not fail. So in this respect, let me say a few words with regard to how India is at the moment trying to convince the world around, both Muslim and non-Muslim world. They've been propagating that it is an issue, it's a fundamentalist issue, that it is an issue of terrorism, that it is intervention by Pakistan. These are three main things which they have been projecting. And strangely, in the Muslim countries, in many of the Muslim countries, I have seen that they have also skillfully projected the idea that why bother about 6 to 8 million Muslims in Kashmir, whereas there are 120 to 140 million Muslims in India also. Therefore, they say that if you talk about these 6 million Muslims, then those 120 million Muslims are all going to be destroyed or killed. And therefore, I learned from many of the people directly from the horse's own mouth that this is the position, and why bother about all this, and why disturb all these 120 million people on the subcontinent. Now, this has again gone against us, and we sometimes fail to explain our position and to convince the Muslim brothers the real situation which is at the moment prevailing as it is. So all these machinations from the Indian side, all told, it has now come to a position where we feel that some decisive phase might come at any time. Now, in that respect, violation of human rights is yet another aspect. Besides the political aspect, there is a very serious aspect of violation of human rights. And as you all read, not only in the Pakistani papers, but you read papers in India, the Amnesty International and Asia Watch, and even the other day Voice of America gave a very harrowing account of what was happening in inside, and the BBC and all the world news media, although the news media to a great extent has been prejudiced against us, but all the same there are things which they cannot hide and they cannot escape propagating. So the violation of human rights has gone beyond all limits, and any exaggeration about the violations would be much less than what it is actually in Kashmir. Molestation, gang molestation of women folk. Now, in India, you see, Sikhs are also waging a war of their own, and there are other people in India who have their movements of secession and separation and whatnot. Nowhere in India have we heard people have been killed, their temples have been destroyed, what not in India, but we have not heard so far that any Sikh or some other lady has been molested in India on account of these activities. But here in Kashmir, the Muslim ladies particularly, whereas there are other people also living on the same soil, and they have been engaged in liberation movement, but it's only they picked up the Muslim ladies particularly, and they've been molested, gang raped, as they call it. So, with all this, the world seems to be sympathizing as far as the violations of human rights is concerned. I'm sorry to say that we have a feeling that it is not attracting that notice which it should have. Mr. Bush the other day pointed out, although indirectly, but the message was very clear, that what is happening on the subcontinent in Kashmir may lead to a larger confrontation in the region, and through the region it might take on the whole world. Now, this nuclear preparation in India, we all know, no matter what one says, but we all know for sure that the nuclear preparation in India is meant only against Pakistan, and through Pakistan against South Asian Muslims and Middle East and Central Asian Muslims. It has no other purpose whatsoever. But India has no threat from us. It is an initiative from the Indian side that whether they have a threat from us or not, it is they who would like to take initiative, and they have dreams of a great Hindu empire from Japan to Morocco. You see, sometimes back they've been planning this, and this Babri Mosque incident was also an incident. It's not an accident, you see, but it is a planned thing. Although our people here in Pakistan have reacted very foolishly, some people have done, but all the same, what was done to Babri Mosque was not an accident in isolation or an emotional outburst of the militant, violent Hindus, but it was all planned over the years. I was told by some very senior foreign diplomats that the Indians are, they claim that there are 1,000 mosques in India, which according to them have been built on the temple sites, and therefore they have also to be demolished. Now, whether this is historically correct or not, but even if it is not correct, they can make out a case and say that 1,000 mosques have been built. Who is there to go and to question them? Because India, somehow or the other, has, like an international villain, India has escaped all retribution. It has escaped all accountability. It is with impunity. It defies, repudiates all international agreements, national agreements, and it just doesn't bother about anybody. I told some of the leading members of the European Parliament, I said, if you people feel that we are in the wrong, I would be happy that you told us so, that we are in the wrong, so that we mend our ways. But if there is somebody in the wrong, why don't you have the courage to go and tell him that you are in the wrong? So, I mean, this is exactly the position that the countries are not in a position today. The Muslim countries alone wield tremendous influence. I'm not talking of the oil reserves and things like that. You will see other tremendous political influence they wield, economic influence they wield, and it is before their eyes what is happening. Now, this question of fundamentalism that I referred to you earlier, I'm sorry to say that the word fundamentalism, the way it is being applied, there is no fundamentalism in Islam. I'm a practicing Muslim myself by the grace of Almighty Allah, but I know there's no such thing as fundamentalism. Fundamentalism, and if at all there was some fundamentalism, I told the European Community the other day, European Parliament, that even if there was some fundamentalism in Pakistan, it was negligible. But what about India, who has 117 members of the Parliament believing in militant Hindu fundamentalism, but their fundamentalism is totally different to Islamic fundamentalism teaches us. I quoted to them a verse from Quran in which said, "Wa'amma ma yanfa'u an-nasa fayamkuthu fil ard." I said, that is the fundamental of Islam, and do you deny it and do you object to it? Do you have any objection to it? But what about Hinduism, where there are millions of untouchables, and everybody who is not a Hindu is an untouchable? The Muslims particularly are more untouchable than a dog according to them. So with all this, you still call us fundamentalists and call them as secularists, you see, and democrats and whatnot. And this, as I was saying, I'm reminded of the fact that it is, though it's not spelled out openly, but in the hearts of the people, I find that amongst the Muslim society, the Muslim society is getting divided over fundamentalists and non-fundamentalists, you see, and liberals and fundamentalists. And that way, India gets an advantage in propagating against all everybody, all Muslims. I told some of the foreigners, diplomats, non-Muslims, I said, we are not fundamentalists, but if you keep pushing us against the wall and dubbing us as fundamentalists, well, someday the people will turn around and say, all right, we are fundamentalists, so what? So I said, why do you do that? I said, when we are not fundamentalists, why do you unnecessarily push us against the wall and say that we are fundamentalists? So I said, I told the gentleman, I said, you live here in Pakistan, you've been here for a long time, you know the liberal, broad-minded society in Pakistan that we have, and in many other Muslim countries we have the same people, but they have their right to exercise their own, live their own way they like, but that is not fundamentalism. But we don't go and claim a sort of a conquest over others for not being Muslims. You see, we, amongst ourselves, whatever we want to be, we would like to be. So that way, it gives an advantage to India for propagating against us and against this movement in Kashmir. In Kashmir, particularly, the Muslims and non-Muslims have lived for ages together, and there has not been a single incident, reported incident, where somebody has been disrespected, or somebody has been maltreated on the basis of his professing some other religion. But all the same, last year you all perhaps know, Excellencies, that by some Indian machination, they evacuated a lot of people, non-Muslims, from Kashmir, projecting the idea that there was some communal trouble. There was absolutely no communal trouble. The houses and properties of those non-Muslims who left Kashmir through this machination are still protected by Muslims there, and they are in contact with each other. But the Hindus said that we are not allowed by the Indian government to go back to Kashmir. Now, that is how India propagates things. And then terrorism. There's absolutely no terrorism. The whole world knows that it is different. Terrorism is different to the movements of resistance. Wherever there is a repression, there will have to be resistance. And this is internationally recognized phenomena. I'm not adding anything to it. There's repression of the worst kind in Kashmir, and there will have to be retaliation. That retaliation cannot be dubbed as terrorism. And but of course, today in this unipolar world, the American, the United States, is in a position to say whatever they like. And till few months back, India was supported by Russia, and she maintained its own integrity, and also it continued with its political power which revealed it. But strange enough that after the breakup of Russia, that responsibility has now been taken on by the United States. It's very strange, the same United States which was objected to by India as having joined the defense pacts, and therefore India said she was not bound to honor the international agreements. The same is now being supported by the United States. But the Muslim countries, certainly, this is the time I'm obliged to say that while with the breakup of Russia, there's so much of feeling and so much of sensing around the question of a new world order. What that new world order is going to be, nobody still knows, as far as I know of the global politics. But anyway, some order has is going to be there, has got to be carved out. And then the tussle, of course, is between who is to shape that future thing, who is to shape the future destiny. Is it the new world order which is going to shape the destiny of the people, or is it the people and the countries who are going to shape the new world order? That is perhaps the tussle which is going on. And the unipolar world cannot stay, as you all know, even as Muslims, and the political philosophy, nothing can in this on this earth can stay unipolar. It'll become bipolar, it'll become multipolar, many things will emerge gradually, and one can see, one can feel around what is happening. Now, in this scenario, I think the OIC, I spoke to the Secretary General also, and our President, he also met the Secretary General and spoke to him and discussed with him the possibility of the OIC asking for a permanent seat in the Security Council on behalf of the OIC as one entity. And I also discussed with him the future possibilities and future prospects of the Muslim countries trying to live in peace themselves, and allowing others to live in peace, giving the impression, at least conveying this impression, because no matter how intellect has developed in the past, but simultaneously the black aspect of this also is very much there, that with the advancement of information and intellect and all that, still some prejudices, very sharp and deep-rooted prejudices, continue, and people continue practically working on them and shaping things on the basis of those prejudices, the Crusades and many things like that, and our own people, follies of our own people. Our own people talking always in terms of political power and using Islam for that purpose. You see, all these things put together have brought us closer to another very serious area of conflict, and that is the religious area. Now, whether somebody spells it today, spells out today or not, but we know for sure that internally in the hearts and minds of the people, there's something as a resurgence of Islam. Now, this has come from Russia itself, because Russia went into Afghanistan not for the sake of hot waters or anything else, but Russians were quite aware and sensitive, alive to the resurgence of religions within Russia. And amongst the religions, of course, Islam is another very powerful force. So that in order to stop that, they moved into Afghanistan, but in fact, they failed. Now, a similar situation is prevailing in India. India is holding Kashmir just for the sake of stopping that resurgence, which the great thinkers of this part of the world have been visualizing in the past. And in order to do that, but sorry for this digression, what I was saying was that this is yet another area of conflict where the Muslims have to play a role. The non-Muslims can hardly play any role in this. It is the Muslim countries, the OSCE, the wise people and the leaders of Muslim countries should sit together and allay this fear from the hearts and minds of the West. The resurgence of Islam would mean total destruction of everybody and killings and massacres and things like that. We are a religion of peace, as I quoted to you the verse from, the fundamental verse from Quran, Mayan, Faranat, Fayam, Kusufalat. So one who is in the service of human beings will stay on earth. That is what we can revert to. And in this process of the new carving out the new world order and addressing various conflicts, I'm absolutely sure, as I mean, I'm not saying anything off the cuff, but I've been moving about in the Muslim communities and the non-Muslim communities, and I know for sure that today there is an opportunity for the Muslim world to sit together, to stand together, and find a way out how to address those conflicts and help in resolving those areas of conflicts by peaceful and by political means. Because while the people want to fight, there are many people, many wise people in this world who don't want to fight, you see, who are scared of resorting to any armed struggle anymore. Therefore, we can take advantage of that and let the world live in peace. And similarly, I was saying about terrorism, I dragged on from terrorism to this aspect. there have been constant efforts by the propaganda machine from across to dub Pakistan as a terrorist country, terrorist state. And the state terrorism which is being conducted unabated by India is not taken a note of. I mean, it's very strange that the Kashmiris who are resisting, they're people tend to call them terrorists, but people who are conducting state terrorism are responsible for the heinous crimes. They're not questioned, you see, and perhaps the state terrorism, according to them, is permissible. But all the same, in the end, my friends, the people in the Arab world perhaps have little access to the kind of Hindu society which it is. It is not possible to imagine by anybody outside India and Pakistan what the Hindu society really means, and what their designs are, and how they're going to treat people, the people, the Muslims in India, the miserable plight that they have suffered all these long years. And of course, the Kashmir now is the crux, is the trial test case for everything. If India, God forbid, succeeds in retaining Kashmir by force and settling things at that, which it is apparently not possible, but I'm just hypothetically talking about it, then of course things will be quite different. And if they fail, they have taken on themselves the responsibility of failure and the consequent breakup of India. We are not interested in breakup of India. The breakup of Russia is already causing a lot of nuisance all around the world. But the breakup of India would further destabilize world peace. Therefore, we are not interested in destabilization or disintegration of India. But if India is headed towards that, what can we do really? We can't do much. I have been saying the last few words that I'm asked time and again, what is it that we can do? So I've been saying that there's so much that we can do, but I'm not suggesting anything aggressive at this stage, because I know the limitations. As a Muslim, I would have suggested anything, but I'm not doing that. See, I know the global obligations. But what I'm suggesting is that wherever there is something wrong, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has himself defined the whole thing, what to do in So this is what the Holy Prophet himself has said. You see, you can't put it down by your hands, then put it down, fight it out with your tongues. If you can't do that, present it in your heart, and that is the weakest portion of the faith. So I'm sorry to say that I feel that perhaps we don't even resent it at heart. See, what India is doing, she's allowed to get away with all this massacre of innocent and poor Muslims, law-abiding citizens, causing no harm to anybody. Kashmiris particularly. If somebody talked about Azad Kashmiris, or people in Pakistan or Afghanistan or Palestine, I would say that they are militant people, and they would also like to fight. But the Kashmiris have been pacifists all 3 centuries. And if they have been forced to resort to this sort of armed resistance, well, one can imagine what would be the conditions which caused them to do this. And I would not add much to it, except reminding you of this, that there is so much that could be done against India. India draws its, according to the experts who deal with this, more than 80% of the Indian exports are consumed by Middle East countries alone. If only India knows that the Middle East countries are annoyed with it. I don't say they stop this trade with them. I don't say they stop their relations with them. But if only India knows that the Muslim countries are annoyed over it, that by itself will send a great message to them to settle things. And then, of course, if Kashmir issue is settled, as the Prime Minister of Pakistan has very rightly pointed out yesterday, day before yesterday, that if the Kashmir issue is settled, then I'm absolutely sure that there'll be no need for development of any nuclear devices on the subcontinent. There'll be absolutely no need for it, and there'll be no need for this huge military build-up, defense build-up, which, of course, has been engineered by Western powers in order to keep supporting their war machines and industries, you see, and provide jobs and earn money out of it, and making a fool of the countries, underdeveloped countries around, and keeping on with their war machine. But however, this is where we are, and I request you, and through you, the Muslim governments and Muslim scholars and Muslim intellectuals and Muslim diplomats, to exercise whatever the influence, in the first instance, to understand the issue. I'm not pointing out, I'm not naming anybody, but the other day, as you know, when this invasion of Kuwait and activity by Iraq was on, I was very clear about it. But if you look at what is happening on the other side, one only feels sorry that there's so much of Indian pressure on the Gulf states that I don't know the Gulf states, for the Gulf states to find it out for themselves. It's not for me to discuss it openly like this, but the Gulf states are internally equally threatened by India, because all arrangements internally have been made to weaken and destabilize those countries from inside. And when it comes to it, they will feel sorry that they have not taken a note of it in time. as I was saying, firstly, the Muslim brothers ought to understand not merely that we are Muslims and therefore we have a cause, but if the case really merits that understanding of it, I think that would do a lot if it is properly. Now, I have diplomats, intellectuals, st- statesmen, journalists coming from all over the world, very senior people, and visiting us in Azad Kashmir. But it's very strange that no dignitaries from the Muslim countries, hardly anybody undertakes a journey to Azad Kashmir to pay us a visit and to find out what is happening. The non-Muslim diplomats, they keep asking for their visit to Srinagar, and they are refused time and again, but they keep asking. But from our side, from the Muslims, the Muslim countries, nobody bothers to ask for going to Srinagar and see what is happening, because they accept that it is an internal matter of India. The non-Muslim countries, they do not accept that it is an internal matter. Why should the Muslim countries accept that it is an internal matter of India? It is not an internal matter of India. It's a global international issue recognized by the United Nations. And the countries here, sitting here and abroad, are all committed in that resolution in the United Nations for resolution of the Kashmir issue on the basis of what had been decided then. So, sir, that was, as I think, one is to understand the issue in its correct perspective, not merely as Muslims, but whether it merits your attention. And then, of course, bringing in moral and political pressure on India to abide by resolutions and resolve the issue. We are very open-heartedly prepared to discuss anything, any one of you who has any contact with them can very, without any inhibition, can talk to them. And if they have a case, it is exactly like what Quran said, Fatu Basurat Misle. If India has any case whatsoever, let us know what the case is. If the case is that it has power, if the case is that it has strength, it has military might, and it has the political power, and it can play the international villain, can get away with it, if that is the case, that is different. But if it has any moral, political, legal case, let us know what the case is. And if they have no case, then it is for the world community, of which you are an equally important part, to decide whether India can be allowed this unilateralism in the world politics, or it can be checked. And then, as I said, the moral, political, and economic pressure can be brought on India, not to destroy India, or not to destabilize India, or not to disintegrate India, but in order to make them see reason and avoid a larger conflict. The conflict in Kashmir has the tendency of spreading around. If it starts spreading around, then it will be very difficult for anyone to stop it, because the kind of temperament that we have on the subcontinent, then it will be do or die. You see, it will not be going back upon it. There will be no rolling back. Therefore, before it starts spreading out and involvement starts increasing, before that is done, I'm absolutely sure that the Muslim countries, the Muslim brothers, collectively, if they took it up very seriously and appreciated the seriousness of the situation and the threat which is brewing up within its cover, they would be very helpful in resolving this area of conflict, which is going to take on more than half of the world already it has involved. And it will be great service to humanity at the same time, and it will be great achievement, I may say, permit me to say that, if this area of conflict is resolved by peaceful and political means, and we on our part, we are doing our best to see. There are people who believe in a militant solution of the issue, but so far the elderly politicians or elderly group of the people, responsible people, they still believe that a military solution is no final answer to the problem on the subcontinent. It has to be a political solution, but militancy somehow or the other was the one which made India realize that there was a problem. I mean, no pleas, no arguments, and no requests, no international agreements, nothing convinced India that there was a problem, but it is only the gun which in Kashmir, taken up by Kashmiris, has brought them around to understand that there is a problem, and this may increase, because the very fact that this is what Indians would accept will lead to the increased involvement in Kashmir. And before that happens, I thought it was my duty to bother you, to give you the trouble of coming here. And with that, I thank you once again from the depth of my heart for being here. Thank you very much. And with this, I request you to join us with some dinner. Thank you very much.
Thank you.